A new in-depth profile reveals massive corruption inside Ukraine. That's according to Time magazine, which writes on Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky. A top Ukrainian presidential advisor has apparently warned that, quote, people are stealing like there's no tomorrow. When asked about bribery and corruption amidst Ukraine's pressure to root out corruption, while it struggles to rally financial support from Western allies following its failed counteroffensive 2 years into the war, according to the article, 59% of Americans do not want Congress to provide more weapons to Ukraine, up from 35% in June. The profile details alleged scandals in Zelensky's circle and says that the president has given strict orders for his staff to, quote, avoid the slightest perception of self-enrichment. Don't buy anything. Don't take vacations. Just sit at your desk, be quiet, and work, according to one staffer.
The profile also says that Zelensky feels betrayed by his Western allies and that they have left him without the means to win the war, only the means to survive it, according to a longtime member of his team. Another close aide said Zelensky, quote, deludes himself, we're out of options, we're not winning, but try telling him that. I think that quote really points out, Robbie, that you have kind of a delusional leader that was told, you know, you have the support of the West, you're going to win this war, we won't let Russia win. And he still believes that. And he's really leading his population in Ukraine in a war that potentially is unwinnable. They've got a shortage of munitions, but a greater shortage of soldiers. Each side of the war has lost over 100,000 people. That's very significant. And Russia still controls the Russian-speaking population in southern Ukraine. I think really it's sad, but it seems time, as I said earlier in the show, to draw lines in the sand, to figure out a way forward that is peaceful, that makes Russia and Ukraine happy, a way that would lift the sanctions and, you know, end U.S. aid going to Ukraine, which is very unpopular among the American people and unpopular in your opinion as well, Robbie.
Yeah, I mean, what is being fought for here? Zelensky makes it sound like it's an existential battle for the country entirely to remain independent, you know, to stop Russia conquering Europe. I mean, if that's what was going on, maybe then our European allies could be bothered, could be roused to contribute to the defense of this nation. Of course, they couldn't. Substantially, it is the U.S. that's been supplying Zelensky with support, with weapons. But they're not. I mean, Russia, frankly, is not. It would be a different story if this were the case, but it's not. Russia is not trying to take over the whole country. It has concerns about regions on its border where there are a lot of Russian-speaking people and there is a lot of loyalty toward Russia. Really, the question is, ought these people to have some self-determination, either to be part of Russia or to be an independent state on the Russian border? I don't understand what is liberal or Western or democratic about saying, no, this border could not possibly change directions at all. That could never happen. Of course, the U.S. has participated in the redrawing of Europe how many times? This is just something that happens. So it doesn't seem worth the thousands and thousands of lives lost, the substantial distraction from a U.S. standpoint, sending all these resources here for what? To overcome the Russian army, to defeat, to overthrow Vladimir Putin? That's not going to happen. That's a fantasy. A fantasy of Joe Biden's, because he's repeatedly said Ukraine's going to get whatever it wants for as long as it wants in order to defeat Vladimir Putin. And in fact, members of the Biden administration spokespeople have suggested that the goal is the fall of Vladimir Putin, an effort that would, I mean, that's fanciful. I mean, maybe there was some chance at some point of that there's some being some kind of uprising in Russia. Didn't work out. Of course, we saw the anti-Vladimir Putin mercenary force try to do that. And what happened? Their leader got blown up in a plane. So let's be clear-eyed about what we're doing in this country. And the corruption, I think, is just important to point out, because so many hawkish neocon people who would have formerly been in the Republican Party but now are substantially in the Democratic Party. As we pointed out, the Republican Party has had enough of funding for Ukraine. The vast majority of Democratic leaders support it. They'll say that this is important because Ukraine is like this key backstop against tyranny. But Ukraine, Zelensky has suspended opposition political parties, suspended hostile independent media, and the government government is incredibly, extremely corrupt. And it was before this war took place. Government corruption, collusion with business, bribery has been a major problem, particularly in Eastern Europe, for a very long time. So what are we doing? Why are we still doing this?
That's the right question, Robbie. I don't think anyone has an answer to that question because people don't like asking that question. The neocon camp is firmly in the camp of, you know, we're still in the Cold War, pretty much. We need Ukraine there. We need to keep up this iron wall that keeps Russia back from taking over Europe. I think they're really stuck in that way of thinking, but the neoliberals are stuck as well. They're stuck in this thinking of there's good guys and there's bad guys, and the Ukrainians, they are our good guys, and the Russians are our bad guys, and there is no winning here. It's only keeping Russia out and ending their imperial project rather than, you know, serving the population, holding an election. I know that's an extremely difficult thing to do in a conflict zone, but let's try and figure out some way what the people in Southeast Ukraine want. What is a way forward that makes both sides happy to end the fighting? 100,000 people dead on either sides. I'm sure the populations of those countries would rather have their brothers and their sisters and their fathers home rather than continuing and fighting this war. For what? For a small land claim for Russia with a population that's largely Russian speaking? And I think, you know, I'm not in the camp of neoliberals or neocons. It's a secret third thing. And it's just, let's get real. There's more nuance than just one side is good and one side is bad. There needs to be a way forward that preserves human life, and a calculation made is U.S. intervention militarily, whether it's sending weapons or what have you, making the situation better or worse? Should we be pushing peace talks?
Yeah, I would just staving off the point at which some kind of negotiation has to happen. And in fact, are we, you know, is Ukraine running out of resources? I mean, it's got to be running out of bodies at some point, especially compared to, you know, the Russian army, which can very sadly and unfortunately can use its people like cannon fodder if it really needs to and has in past conflicts. Are we just getting to the point where will Russia actually have a stronger bargaining position when Ukraine is so depleted that maybe they could get even more? I mean, I think that's a real concern that Putin says, actually, you know, they're out of ways to defend themselves. I can push this even further. That would be a travesty. That would be our aid actually putting Ukraine eventually in a worse position, because it is going to end. The American people do not have a strong appetite to continue being this generous with this country for this reason. So we have to be honest with that. The American people think these dollars could be better spent at home, and they're not being spent particularly well. In fact, they're being involved in bribery schemes, and to the extent they're weapons, they get left behind. Who's picking them up? Are we arming Russians? Are we arming some third group? You know, how many times have we swooped in there, left all our toys behind, only to find out they've been sold to terrorists, if not picked up by terrorists? How does this help U.S. security? Why won't our leaders think about what's best for U.S. national security? It's only their main job. It's only their most important job. But it's. I mean, this is the kind of America last philosophy that that annoyed conservatives enough to embolden someone like Donald Trump, who spoke out against it, and are prepared to do exactly that yet again for the same reason. So yeah, we will.
Let's think about the country we're protecting as well. Ukraine today is not the same Ukraine we decided to support initially. The Ukraine today that we have is not a country with a population that wants to be Europe, a part of Europe. It's not a country that wants to be a part of NATO. It's a country, as the profile reflected, that is riddled with corruption. A top presidential advisor said that people are stealing like there's no tomorrow. And that's really the state of people in Ukraine. They don't see a tomorrow for their country. They don't see an end to this war. And so what's going to happen if we let this continue to go on? We continue to let the population of Ukraine grow these anti-Western sentiments. We continue to let the population of Ukraine die in a war with a no foreseeable end because the United States supports it. We're really sowing anti-American sentiments, I'm sure, among the youth population there. Think about the shakeups, not just corruption-wise under the Zelensky administration, but also with personnel that were formerly in the Azov battalion that were then elevated to positions of leadership, and then the firings of people and the corruption. What is the state of Ukraine internally? And is that a country that, if we push it to continue to be in this war, is in a good shape to be a sovereign, functioning nation once the war ends? I think we really need to make that calculation as well for the sake of the Ukrainian people we're supposedly protecting.